Right now, Lobster and I are both probably best, maybe 1%. It's not enough to make the primary. It's tough for libertarians. I'm a well-known public figure in the science and technology world. I'm a successful entrepreneur. I've done well enough where I really don't have to work anymore. I'm a Silicon Valley entrepreneur who's had a lot of success, and we get a ton of media coverage on my campaign. I'm formerly a journalist with National Geographic, also with the New York Times. I've done a lot of things, and I'm still not able to get into the debates. I'm still not able to get into the polls. I'm still not able to generate enough media attention to take on people like Gavin Newsom. This is a reflection of not necessarily either Wildstar or myself. This is more a reflection, I think, of the vision of the Libertarian Party. And I think we should take an opportunity, this convention, to really look at how one day, after 46 years, we might actually be able to win races. Now, I know in some of the local races, we can't win. But in the major races, we've had that major problem. We're not serving the U.S. Congress. We're not serving the presidency. We're not serving as governors. In order for that to change, the party is going to have to grow and, I think, incorporate new types of ideas. As a public figure in the science and technology world, I've tried to bring in a number of radical ideas. Ideas that challenged a lot of the bylines of the Libertarian Party. They're not un-libertarian. In fact, I've always tried to incorporate libertarianism. I've written a novel about libertarianism. It's one of the best-selling libertarian novels of this century. But the issue at hand has been, we're not making enough headway when it really comes to winning races. And I think as we have this debate tonight, let us take a longer look, and maybe at the convention later speaking at the Democratic and also tomorrow, how the Libertarian Party might actually succeed. It's not just about the values we have right now. It's about expanding upon the values we have. It's about taking on the Democrats and the GOP in a way that we have not done before in order to win races. And so as we go on today, I hope you consider some of my more radical ideas in order to win races. Thank you so much.
The first question goes back to you, Zoltan, and that is, what makes you a credible candidate? 2 minutes.
Well, all my life I've been working very hard at trying to be a certain person. I'm an Ivy League graduate, took a degree in philosophy from Columbia University. I was one of the youngest writers ever to start the National Geographic channel, and also National Geographic itself. In fact, I think I'm the second youngest. I've traveled to over 100 countries, 102 actually, mostly for National Geographic, also been a war zone correspondent. I've done an amazing amount of things actually, including starting a business that really thrived. I'm married to a medical doctor. She's an OBGYN. She works at Planned Parenthood, which is controversial for some people, but I stand very much behind those kinds of things. I have dedicated a huge amount of the last 20 years to becoming a very viable candidate on paper, so that I can actually compete against a lot of the other gubernatorial candidates, at least when it comes to paper. And that's one of the reasons that I have gotten a huge amount of media coverage. As I mentioned yesterday, I've gotten about 50 to 70 million views in my gubernatorial race so far in the last 18 months. It's been dramatic. You've seen, everyone probably in this room has seen the amount of attention it's getting. And yes, a lot of it is towards transhumanism, science, technology, radical ideas like that. But that has made me very credible in terms of the Libertarian Party, in terms of major media, has been covering me like wildfire. And at least I have spread values of liberty. While I might not have a chance of winning the governorship, I've been spreading liberty as fast as I can.
Absolutely.
1 minute.
Well, one of the things that would make me the most qualified to serve as governor is I don't have any special interests. I don't have any ulterior motives.
I'm sorry, I want to interrupt you. I didn't mean for you to answer the question. I meant, did you want to rebut what he said?
Oh, no, not at all.
Excellent. Answer the question, 2 minutes.
As I was saying, I'm not some self-serving person that's looking to serve anything else other than the people of California. And I think integrity is what's been missing the most, and that's one of the things that I've been able to communicate to the people of this state. I actually went around petitioning to gather signatures to get onto the ballot, meeting voters face to face, have been touring throughout the state and have been shaking hands and kissing babies, that sort of thing, and just communicating with the average voter. What is it that you want out of the state? And really, they just want government to get out of their lives. And I let them know that if that's ultimately what you want, then your best bet is to vote Libertarian. And I'm a grassroots candidate, so the majority of the support that I've been getting has been from that ground game, going around the state and meeting with people. And although it's been looked at as being a waste of time, I found it to be not only rewarding, but extremely advantageous. It's gotten me into the San Fran Chronicle and Sacramento Bee, and I've also been courted to be on a new pilot show for Cartoon Network for tweeners, and it's a political show. So I'll be on that show, and I'm looking forward to have the opportunity to express the ideas of what the Libertarian Party could do as a political party to the next generation. And that's what it takes most, is us being able to communicate what the Libertarian Party can do as an alternative, since the majority of people are sick and tired of the old establishment parties.
Thank you.
So I just think, in all honesty, and this has been something that's been shocking to me, is the credibility factor. My opponent doesn't have a college degree. He doesn't have real executive experience in the business world. California is a multi-trillion dollar economy. The idea of running something this massive, it takes incredible amounts of credibility. I'm not even pretending that I have. I've said openly that I'm probably not qualified to be governor of California. That's just simply a fact when you look at, you know, the history of the people who are doing these things. So, you know, in real terms, I tried to run to spread liberty, and because, from a libertarian perspective, I probably have the best resume and credibility. I appreciate the grassroots stuff, but honestly, there's 40 million Californians. That's not how you win a campaign here. You win it because you have stature.
You may have a response to that.
Absolutely.
So, as I said to you guys before, I've been going around and meeting people face to face. And in speaking with them, one of the things that they've also communicated to me is that they're sick and tired of Ivy League know-it-alls pretending to be. These egg-headed scholars coming in telling them that they know better than what they can do for themselves. And that's exactly what these career politicians have proven us since they have had that Ivy League education. They failed weak people, and they failed the middle-class income earners. That is what I represent.
This question goes straight to you, Nicholas. How can we address the massive wasteful spending that California is doing?
Absolutely. Well, one of the first things that I said is we can eliminate the amount of wasteful spending that we're spending on our state representatives. We have thousands of state representatives that receive six-figure salaries. You can go on transparentcalifornia.com and just see for yourself how many state representatives get paid this amount of money. We have UCLA professors, the UCLA football coach getting $3.5 million. That's ridiculous when you have teachers in our K-12 program suffering off and struggling off of $30,000, $40,000 a year. It's seriously unbalanced, and the amount of money that will be cut first will be the amount of money with the state representatives. Starting first with myself, which is why I said I will reduce the current governor's salary, which is nearly $200,000, to $99,000. And every other state representative will be under that amount as well. So that's a way that we can reduce the amount of wasteful spending that's going into our state representatives. I also would like to eliminate the property tax. The state property tax to allow homeowners to be able to build and develop on the land, and of course remove the regulations that are preventing them from being able to develop more housing, affordable housing, to those in need. We need to be able to supply our demand. And also I would like to level the state's sales tax to just 7%. And that, along with eliminating the income tax, which is currently 13% to zero, would allow the people of the state to have more money to spend on the things that matter the most. Keeping food on their tables, keeping a roof over their heads, being able to provide for themselves and their families.
Okay, I didn't hear how you reduce spending. Can you please give me 30 seconds on how you reduce spending?
Well, spending on the state representatives. Government gets its money from we the people, the taxpayers of this state. So when we talk about tax revenue, that's exactly where they're collecting it from. The hard workers of this state that are paying into this system. So we waste a lot of money on our state representatives, and are, because of that, seeing a lack of representation in places like the state of Jefferson. We have nearly 30 counties in Northern California that want to secede away from the state of California. And that's because of the lack of representation that they have there in the state.
Time.
The excessive taxes. We need to cut that.
2 minutes, same question.
Well, I feel very similar to Wildstar. I mean, these are classic libertarian ideas, and of course I uphold them. I think the very first thing, actually, I get into the governorship, I would do a giant audit on everything and see where the wasteful spending is. It's very obvious that California has such an enormous bureaucracy. It's very obvious that California has so much wasteful spending going on, and a lot of people would be fired. I would downsize a huge amount of the different agencies and the different bureaucracies and the different institutions that are out there. I would tackle the pension issue that we have, which is completely out of control. And it's probably going to, at some point, bankrupt California here in the next 10 to 12 years if we don't do something about it. And unfortunately, the only thing to really do about the pension issue is probably to, you know, at least that's the Democrats are going to say, to raise taxes, and Republicans will probably say the same thing. But ultimately, what I want to do is just, even if it's going to be very difficult, start cutting and start firing people. Because ultimately what we need to do is just streamline the entire government and get it out of our faces. Until government is out of our face, and I say this from somebody who is a real estate entrepreneur, who has done a lot of development, and who literally finds it impossible to build anything in California anymore. I can just tell you that the regulation makes it so absolutely impossible. We simply need to go in and cut at least 50% of the regulation right off the bat and take a look at the next 25% and really just keep the very basic essentials in. If you don't do that, we're going to run into a problem here in about 10 or 12 years where not only pensions are going to skyrocket, but all infrastructure is starting to fall apart. Without those kinds of things in place, without a governor that's actually going to do that, we're going to find that California is going to literally fall into at some point. And it's going to be a wave of bankruptcies all across the state, and people will continue to leave in droves as they are right now.
Thank you.
That's actually my campaign platform. Anybody here that knows anything about my campaign, that's what I've been saying this whole time. Is first things first, upon assuming the office of governor, that I will be conducting a full-scale audit of the state's finances. This will not be done by the state auditor's office. This will be done completely independently by people of the public. We have accountants and people involved in financing here in the state of the community that would love to get their hands on the state's books. So that's one of the ways that we can eliminate the amount of spending that we have in the state, is by first seeing where we have been wasting our money this whole time. These regulatory agencies, there's over 300 here in the state, and most of them are productive and unnecessary. They need to be cut altogether. The amount of spending here in the state is basically just on pet projects and on state
time.
Representatives. We cut the spending there first, we have tons of money
time
to spend.
So then you're
No, I think, you know,
okay.
Wildstar and I share very similar views when it comes to what we can do to implement a libertarian policy in government. It's obviously there's tons of wasteful spending.
Okay. This question goes to Zoltan, and this is, what is the biggest issue for Californians today, and what will you do about it? 2 minutes.
Well, easily the biggest issue is poverty. 13 million households are living
at near or right above the poverty line, which is $24,000 per household. So something must be done for that. I have suggested a very controversial plan that a lot of people in the Libertarian Party here haven't liked, but I'm happy to talk about it because it's gaining national attention, and I've been writing about it recently for Cato and other places like that. It's called a federal land dividend, where we would take approximately some of the 40% of California's unused land. So 40% of California is federal land, it's unused, and try to monetize that. We could either pay off California's debt, we could either apply some of the money just to people, we could lower taxes entirely, pay people even a, God forbid, a basic income of something. Either way, it wouldn't raise taxes whatsoever, and it would shrink different types of governments, like welfare, like food stamps, like the kinds of things that we want to see shrunk. There's just an enormous amount of empty resources there. It seems amazing to me that we have 13 million households that are literally in poverty, worrying about food, never going to travel with this nature anyways. We should try to do something to help them. Besides the libertarian policy of just streamlining the government and eliminating a lot of the bureaucracy in it, I think we ought to try to utilize a lot of the federal land to help California to be better off economically. And that could be anything, like I said, from paying off the debt to lowering your taxes for the next 10 years. But whatever it is, we have a huge amount of resources here. We have $10 to $20 trillion. We have $5 trillion of undeveloped coastal line that the criminal of California Coastal Commission won't let us develop. These are resources that we can use to solve problems. And this is very unique libertarian thinking. It's a libertarian plan that can literally change our fortunes in major politics. Thank you.
Well, it's definitely the number one problem in the state of California for its people is definitely the amount of money. It's terribly disproportionate, and it can be simply balanced out with just allowing the people of the state to have more money. And that's why I've been promoting to eliminate the state's income tax, to give the hard workers of this state, no matter how much money that you're making, to be able to keep that money. Even with our businesses, they're being double taxed. They're being taxed as a business, then their personal income tax is being taxed. So we're chasing away businesses, we're chasing away people, we're chasing away everybody that comes to the state of California that look for more prosperity. And although my opponent says he's considering this universal basic income, that's one of the things that he's been promoting the most. And to that, I would say no. I would say to someone such as himself, if you'd like to create a universal basic income, let it be independently not independent and not under the control of the government. So him and his friends in Silicon Valley are more than welcome to create that program and make it available to the public, but it will not be another government informed and instituted and created.
I didn't call it a universal basic income, and I've called it a federal land dividend. It's a totally different concept. It doesn't raise taxes, and it will absolutely shrink the different types of government bureaucracies that are out there. It would literally eliminate food stamps, it would literally eliminate Social Security, it would literally eliminate the government health care programs, it would literally eliminate all these things. And I can assure you, the reason it's gaining a lot of national attention and international attention, because it works anywhere, is not because it's a poor idea. It's a great idea. It's an idea that time is going to come. It's not a basic income. It's a land dividend. Milton Friedman and other people like that have talked about similar ideas. This goes back to libertarians all
time.
The way.
Next one is for, I'm sorry, you want 30 seconds for the
Yes.
30 seconds, go ahead.
Well, to counter that, I would promote a negative tax. And that basically means that anybody under a certain income would basically receive a tax return. They wouldn't have to pay taxes, and they get to keep their money. And that would be a way to incentivize the people of the public to get more involved in the community and provide more solutions to help each other, opposed to thinking that government can provide all of the solutions for you. They cannot.
Am I able to rebut
that? You want to rebut that? Sure. 10 seconds, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm not
sorry, 30 seconds. Go ahead.
I'm not going to give any favors to poor people. I'm sorry. The idea that I have is a dividend that gets paid to everybody, rich or poor. I'm simply not going to make favors. It would be very anti-libertarian to make favors like that. So my proposal does not distinguish between who's poor or who's rich. Everybody gets a piece of that land because all of us own that land.
This question goes to Nicholas. Assuming that you do not win, what impact can you still make? 2 minutes.
Impact that I'm hoping to make the most upon the public is to let them know that there is a viable third option, and it's the Libertarian Party. Let them know that we are the ones that are in position to challenge the two-party system. We do have the intent, which is to serve the people of our community, which is why the people involved in the party themselves are volunteers. We're not corporate sponsored. We don't have big banks behind us and big special interests. And that is one of the things that the people of the community have seen to be invaluable in the libertarian option. So the people that I've been meeting in the community, first-time voters, people that never voted before, whether it be straight out of high school or somebody in their 30s and 40s that never seen the political system as ever being beneficial to them, and letting them know that we are the solution, because we want to get government out of your business. We want to get government for being involved in your personal choices, and we want to get government out of your pocketbook. Unlike the Republicans, unlike the Democrats, they all say it, but they don't follow through. We say it, we mean it, and that's exactly what I offer as a candidate, is letting people know that I say what I mean. So if I don't, I will retire in 2 years and give it to our lieutenant governor, who I'm pretty sure will be more than capable to pick up where we left off. But more than that, just let the people of California know that they have true representatives that will reflect them and their interests. And that's all that matters the most.
I shall answer the question.
2 minutes, please.
So if you've been following my campaign, you'll know some of the things that I've been doing. I spoke as a libertarian at the World Economic Forum. I got an argument with the president of Chile about libertarianism, who said she supported Governor Brown. I have been doing endless amounts of speeches, endless amounts of articles, big places, Wired, Newsweek, Times of London was at my house, ABC Nightline, David Ryan correspondent was at my house for 3 weeks, just about 2 weeks ago. As you might be following, there's been an enormous amount of media. And what am I going to do when this campaign's over? Well, I'm going to continue doing the exact same thing. I'm going to continue generating about 500,000 views a day of my work, which is always tied to my libertarian inklings, my libertarian philosophy. There's simply no way around that. And that's simply one of the things I've been trying to tell a lot of the LP staff members who have been critical of my work, is that I am spreading liberty like no other 2018 candidate is. And that is something to say for the movement. It's something to say for the party. And it's also something to say in just a philosophical push of what it means to try to live in a free world.
The one thing that I've come to find by speaking with people is they just see politics as being a bunch of advertisements. Big fancy posters and billboards and commercials and radio ads. It's just all seen as a way to vie for their attention, when it should be genuine, it should be authentic. And that's something that I've been offering to the people of California by letting them know that I am one of you. I'm not going to pretend to be something that I'm not. I'm not some Ivy League scholar, and I don't have millions of dollars. The one thing about the debates is the old establishment candidates, it cost $100,000 in campaign donations to even get on stage. It cost $4,000 to get on the ballot almost. It cost $2,000 plus to get a campaign statement. And when I let people know that their political system is bought out, then they see even more with their own eyes of why a change is needed now.
Look, I don't mean to be a jerk, but I just say it honestly, $100,000 for us who live in Silicon Valley and are entrepreneurs is not a lot of money. And if the Libertarian Party can't understand that, it's never going to win. And that's the big issue here. I'm trying to say that we need a whole different type of agenda, one that might actually win. Because right now, we're in the, like, the minors. And until we get into the big leagues and start competing with people on a real level, we're never going to be able to do that. So we need to start thinking a lot bigger. We need, it's much more than just grassroots meeting and shaking hands. I mean, we need multimedia network access on a daily level. These are the kinds of things that move the party forward, and these are the kinds of things that I have been bringing to my California gubernatorial race.
The stage has been set, and the big news is here. The people are ready. They want the change. They see how the duopoly is the same, and with this next gubernatorial race here in California, the people are ready to vote Libertarian. I've been speaking with them myself, and they're just ready to get away from Republican or Democrat. There's 11 Democratic candidates, 8 Republican candidates. If they split the vote and get, if as a Libertarian I come in and get $300,000 votes, we'll be in the general election in November, and that's all it that matters.
Sorry, we're going to get 1%, maybe 2%. We're going to split the ticket. Nothing's going to go anywhere. But 50, 70 million people have heard about libertarianism, maybe a million through Wildstar. That's the way we grow this party. But like I said, the more important thing is the philosophical shift. We really need to join the big leagues. And that means getting together as a party and deciding how we can start doing that. It's a lot more than just kind of coming here and room full of a few hundred people and saying, oh, we're going to win. We're not going to win yet. We need to come up with ideas that can make us win, and that's hard. It makes me look like the bad guy, but it's the reality. I'm sorry to say it, but it's the truth.
All right, Zoltan, I'd like you to feel free, think of any question you'd like to ask Nicholas.
I didn't get enough time to prepare for this. But I will say something that was very interesting, and I'd like to talk about it because I think education is one of the most important issues in California right now. And Nicholas Wildstar shared an article on his Facebook page. I don't know if he represents this, but either way, I was a little bit astonished to find out that the LP, because student loans are not constitutional, there was no mandate in the Constitution to do that, that student loans perhaps could be forgiven and should be forgiven as LP policy. And Wildstar shared this, and I'd like to hear more about his idea on it, and whether that is something that he would do. Would you forgive all student loans?
2 minutes.
Well, as he pointed out, in the Constitution, it does not give the federal government any authority whatsoever to establish a Department of Education. The loans that, have been issued to students have been fraudulent. Sallie Mae, which is now Navient, has been discovered time and time again for fraudulently issuing loans to borrowers that are extremely predatory. Our federal government right now is suing Navient over this discrepancy. As a Libertarian candidate, I'm just going to be honest with the people of California, and after we perform this audit of the state's finances, if we see that they've been issuing dirty loans, we're going to let the people know that we're going to discharge this debt, you're not going to have to pay it back, and every criminal that issued you this loan will be jailed. That's what we need.
Well, yeah, I agree with everything Wildstar said, but I think the bigger argument was whether loans should be forgiven as a whole, and I think that's a much larger issue. The reality is, if we even attempted to forgive the loans, let's just say in California, let's say America, we would find ourselves in another great recession. And the problem that comes with this type of thinking is when someone hasn't been in business and hasn't made a lot of money and hasn't been successful at it, they don't understand how market economics works. And the problem is, you can't do those things. If I was to become governor, yes, I don't think necessarily we should be in the government student loan market either. But you can't shift these things overnight, because the economies would collapse. People would lose millions of dollars, and then we'd really be in a big, tough position as we were just about 5 or 7 years ago. So while I understand the LP policy on this, you have to be more pragmatic to win. If you tell this to any bankers or any Wall Street people, they will literally laugh at us. And that's why they haven't been laughing at us.
We need to have
people stop laughing at the LP.
Time.
That's by being realistic.
Well, the people that's put in position to lose all of this money are the people that have been using usury and a system, an economic system that's built on debt. We're putting the people of our country deeper into debt. We're putting the people of this state here into debt. You know how many teachers that I talk to have student loan debts themselves that are teaching our children? We need to help them out as well. We can't continue to dig the people of this state deeper into debt. So if anything is better by eliminating the student loan debt, we give some money back to the people.
The question is, where does that money that we're giving back to the people come from? I mean, ultimately what's happened is, yes, maybe it was a bad system, and maybe it shouldn't have been done, but we're in it, and this is the way the world is. And when we pull out levers, we pull out pins, the whole castle comes falling down. And it's something that a lot of libertarians don't really understand, because either they don't have enough money or they haven't had their own businesses, but you need to be more pragmatic. I hate government regulation too, but in order to take on the major parties, we have to be more realistic in terms of business and policy.
Time.
And that's when you can't forgive college loans outright.
Time. All right, Nicholas, please think what you would like to ask him one question.
I know exactly what I would like to ask him. Just recently, in the San Fran Chronicle that I was featured in, you were also made a statement about how, as governor, you would use public funding to battle the disease of debt, which you deem is a problem. You also said how you would create a robot army as well as armed drones to surveil our schools. How would you fund this, and do you think that they would actually, these robot, you know, protectors, would be more sensible and reliable than our human ones that have create errors all the time?
Well, there's two minutes. There's two questions there. And the first is, after the massacres that have occurred, I put on an idea trying to defend the Second Amendment, saying that we could use drones and we could use different types of robots in schools in order to protect students. I never said anything that this would have to come from government funding. In fact, I mentioned these would come from companies like Boeing and Lockheed Martin and all these other things. We could create a huge amount of economic boom through the use of these types of technologies to prevent mass shootings. And just so you know, after the Las Vegas massacre, a lot of this stuff is already in place. In fact, I had an email from the CEO that's working on this right now from the major company. But let's talk about the second question, a lot bigger. It applies to the non-aggression principle. Look, we're on the verge. You may not believe this, you may not like it, you may think it's insane. Whether you like it or not, it's happening. There are billions and billions of dollars funding into life extension research, and those of us that are under age 50 now have a very good shot of not having to die if you can live to 80 or 90, based on how far genetic editing technology and the ability to just modern medicine is evolving. This is something I think remarkable. And I think if we're going to use any government funds on any kinds of disease for the people, we ought to try to tackle the life extension industry. And the life extension industry, in terms of Silicon Valley, is not only going to make a lot of money, but it can also make us live a lot better. When you talk about doing something for people, when you talk about the kinds of technologies and sciences out there that can help, well, of anyone, this is almost like enemies coming up our beach to shoot us. I feel that death, when you apply it to the non-aggression principle in terms of disease, is something that libertarians can get behind to try to work with government and work with also private companies to stop. And I stand right behind that.
Well, as grandiose as your offers sound, it's still missing a bit of factual data. And after tremendous studies, scientists and doctors have concluded the number one killer amongst humans, it isn't smoking or drinking or gun violence or anything like that, it's lack of social interaction. People not connecting with each other anymore, that increases your stress level, that increases your the risk of heart attacks, as well as all of this other factual data. So none of your technology is going to prevent that. Organic life extension is us getting off our cell phones, getting off our communities, connecting with one another, and loving each other.
Yeah, anyways, so just so everyone knows, one of the reasons that there's so much media coverage about my work is because I'm one of the world leaders in transhumanist and the life extension movement, person who talks to heads of state and advises the US Navy and things like that. We are on the verge of these technologies, and the number one killer of human beings right now is heart disease.
Thank you. All right, but I know I said I was going to have some questions from the audience, and unfortunately we've run out of time. So I'm going to have to go right to their closing statements. Apologize, guys. We did run short on time. I apologize. Do you want to do one question? No, we're out of time. We are out of time. I apologize. So all the way we're done. Each of you will do a 3-minute closing. If you can start, we'll come to the grade. 3-minute closing statements.
Well, of course, I got thrown for a loop there by bringing in the transhumanist and life extension ideas for which I'm well known. And of course, many of the libertarians dislike that. And that's kudos to Wildstar for doing that. Because obviously, it's been a tough mission for me, somebody who's been libertarian for a solid 10 years, to talk about some of the radical science and technology that I do talk about. But ultimately, what's really happened here is the transhumanist movement, the life extension, the radical science and technology movements that I represent is growing bigger than the libertarian movement, and it will continue to grow until it's something of the size of the environmental movement, billions of people. It's an honor for me to be really one of the world leaders of it. It's very important that I think people in the room understand when they ask me, what am I doing in the governor's run? Well, I can tell you one of the things I'm doing. I'm trying to steer one of the most important future social movements of the world to remain libertarian. Because in case you haven't seen, the environmental movement has been weaponized by the left. And that's exactly where the science radical technology movements are actually going. They're also going to be weaponized by the left. If we don't do something, if somebody like me doesn't stand up and try to say, pound the table and say, we need libertarian values in these things, they're never going to come across. It's going to be a movement that ultimately turns left. We will be in this building in 20 years, and the same losses will be happening. When I talked about trying to do something different with the LP, yes, I'm trying to push it to be a futurist party, a party that actually embraces ideas that the Republicans and the Democrats won't because they're scared of them. I mean, who remembers any science or technology being spoken about in the presidential debates? Nobody does, because they don't do that. It's scary for them. It doesn't win voters. But I think the Libertarian Party has a real chance right now to talk about some of these issues, to talk about federal land dividends, to talk about reparations, to end the war on drugs, not just end the war on drugs, but actually offer reparations to people that have been busted, the 3 or 4 million Californians who have been busted for minor drug offenses. We have an opportunity with the Libertarian Party to take on some brand new ideas and try to come on par with the Democrats and the GOP. But that's going to take very revolutionary types of thinking. I can see a lot of faces. People are kind of like, ooh, some of that stuff's too weird. Living forever or whatever this. I understand it's all weird. However, if I could explain to you the amount of money going into the field, where it's no longer just $50 million, it's hundreds of billions of dollars floating into Silicon Valley, floating into these types of technologies that are going to change our world. Will capitalism even survive in the age of automation? Something we didn't talk about. A lot of experts don't think so. What are the libertarians going to do when capitalism disappears? It's been the backbone of our philosophy, laissez-faire economics. These are different ways and different methods that we need to kind of think about and embrace. And I have been leading the charge in the party of getting libertarians all around the country to think about this, and also people all around the world to hear about libertarianism for the first time and hear it in these in a different manner. It's not just gun-toting hippies smoking pot. It's actually people where there's a lot of money being made and there's a lot of excitement about the
future. Time.
Thank you for your instability.
Thank you. I'm a writer, so I actually wrote a little something that I would like to read to you guys. When we're kids growing up, we're told that there's nothing in the world that we cannot do, that all of our dreams can come true and anything we can imagine is possible. We're told this because in each and every one of us lies untapped potential, and as future contributors of society, we don't want to impose any limitations. I believed in this American dream so much that I moved to California from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, right after high school to pursue a career in music. I worked hard and diligently at it and started to see how all of my efforts were paying off. But I also started to notice some of the blockades that were holding me back from being more successful. Copyright laws and trademarking costs, all inevitable and necessary in order for me to conduct my business, making music. Something that I found so easy to do was increasingly becoming more and more difficult. This is what the path to adulthood looks like. And once you've made it only so far, all of your dreams start to shatter before your eyes. Now people are telling you to grow up and get real. You end up joining the workforce and slaving away at some dead-end job you hate just to live paycheck to paycheck. We the people should not have to slave away to support a service-based economic system that has done nothing to support us or allow us to create our own wealth. The government has tricked us into believing that it is the best service provider for healthcare, education, housing, security, and many other social needs. They fail at providing us with anything of quality, but most of all, they fail to honor the trust that we the people have given them to govern responsibly. This is why I'm running for governor of California, because I know that from speaking with everyday people here in the state, that they are ready to not be taxed into debt, not be told how to live their lives, not be told how to grow up when they are grown up themselves. Responsible and respectful adults who work hard and pay their bills and provide for their families, don't want government involved in their lives at all.
30 seconds.
As the first Libertarian governor, it would be my honor to bring back liberty to our political system and restore the power of the people back to those in the community. The best service the government can provide is to get out of the way from keeping people to live free. So I hope that you will support my campaign and vote Wildstar for governor on June 5th, 2018.
Thank you to YouTube for hosting this video and for being an essential part of human progress by making video hosting available worldwide to everyone on the internet. However, the next phase in human progress is here with steemit.com and their video hosting alternative blockchain-based solutions, including DTube. And you can find that through steemit.com as well as my own page there at Adam Kokesh. This is a decentralized blockchain-based social media network that pays you fairly for your content. Already, I'm regularly making more there with a single post than I do from an entire month on YouTube. So please join us on the next frontier of the information revolution at steemit.com. And if you want help getting a leg up there, I'm happy to re-steam your posts and make sure that no one is starting from scratch. Just email me one of your favorite posts at adam@thefreedomline.com and we'll share it on my feed.